Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to the DRMA lecture at DePaul University. It's my pleasure. I'm Sister Betty Ann McNeil, first of all, who I work as the Vincentian Scholar in Residence in the Office of Mission and Values. And it's my pleasure to introduce our speaker today, Sister Sung-Hae Kim of the Sisters of Charity of Seton Hill. Sister Sung-Hae entered the Sisters of Charity in 1965 and made her final vows in 1972. Her congregation is based in Chicago. They're generalate and serves the province of Korea and the province of the United States, and also has missions in Ecuador and China, I believe. Focusing on the history of religions, Sister Sung-Hae earned her doctorate in theology from Harvard University and is a professor emerita in the Department of Religious Studies, Sungan University in Seoul, Korea. At present, Sister serves as the General Superior for the Sisters of Charity of Seton Hill. Sister Sung-Hae is a deep thinker, prolific writer, gracious collaborator, and speaks with a gentle voice as she's made significant contributions using her studies in the field, looking at Seton writings and contributions and legacy through a lens of culture and historiography, to examine diverse belief systems of Christians and non-Christians. Among her published articles and books, her most recent published in Vincentian Heritage is on the topic about which she will speak today, but there are several others. One book is The Righteous and the Sage, a comparative study on the ideal images of man in biblical Israel and classical China. Another, Monasticism, Buddhist and Christian. Another, The Gourd and the Cross, Taoism and Christianity in Dialogue. Sister Sung-Hae also specializes in Setonian studies, inspired by the writings of St. Elizabeth Ann Seton. Sister Sung-Hae will reflect today on Seton writings and contemporary ecologists, on their philosophies regarding the care of our common home, the earth. Please welcome Sister Sung-Hae, who will present the ecological spirituality of Elizabeth Ann Seton. Sister Sung-Hae.
Thank you. It's a real pleasure for me to be here. And I thought that it would be probably best if I read with you together the quotations of St. Elizabeth Ann Seton and how I see her ecological spirituality. So I will talk about 40 minutes, and then I hope we have some sharing afterward, about 15 or 20 minutes. So. It is a great pleasure for me to have this time to share with you the highlights of the article I wrote on the ecological spirituality of Elizabeth Seton for the recent volume of Vincentian Heritage. For the last 7 years while living in Chicago, I used my spare time as well as annual retreats to read the collected writings of Elizabeth Bailey Seton. Reading Elizabeth's letters and journals have been a joy, for on every page I can discover a treasure which touches my heart. Finding an amazing insight in her writings that the natural and human world are interwoven in the life, order, and beauty of God. I decided to write on her ecological spirituality, even though no one seemingly had attempted it. Elizabeth Seton saw an inseparable interconnection between nature and human life, and she perceived both life and death as the necessary cycle of creation. She was convinced that we humans have a special calling, like the corals in the ocean, to be transformed by sufferings and hardships through which we learn to trust God and attain the freedom of heart or the state of holy indifference. Elizabeth Seton's ecological sensitivity enriches our understanding of providential interdependence between nature and our human life. I drew her ecological insights from Volume 1, a collection of Elizabeth's correspondence and her journals from 1793 to 1808, when she left New York for Baltimore in order to respond to a calling as a religious. So this is the text that I drew upon, Volume 1 of her collected writings. In her writings from age 19 to 34, the following four characteristics emerge as constitutive elements in her ecological spirituality. The beauty of nature was the space wherein she encountered with God and friends, and also she felt abandoned. Elizabeth identified herself with the surrounding natural environment and therein experienced consolation and God's mercy. Elizabeth saw God's equity in nature and learned ecological balance that accepts both life and death, joy and suffering, while recognizing the rhythm of time in nature. Elizabeth realized the importance of living in the present and learned to be content in all situations by acquiring the virtues of moderation and harmony. I'll present a few examples of the four characteristics of Elizabeth's ecological spirituality from her writings. 1. Nature as the space for encounter with friends and God. Elizabeth found happiness in the beauty of nature, sunrise, sunsets, the peaceful flow of a river, clean air, and singing birds. First one, Elizabeth's letter to Elijah Sadler, that's one of her very close friends, about the death of the husband of their mutual friend, Julia Scott. The last time I wrote you, I meant to have had a letter ready for whatever opportunity presented, but fate orders all things. And since that time has ordered the husband of my little Julia Scott to the regions of peace. I have not left her night or day during the excess of her sorrow. It was noteworthy that Elizabeth used the term fate here. In later years, when her son William mentioned fate, Elizabeth corrected him, saying, "You say tide of fate, my beloved son." And so the poet says, "But I say tide of providence, which is infinite goodness." It is beautiful to see how Elizabeth slowly grew into total confidence in the merciful providence of God. And another example, Elizabeth's letter to her father when faced with her husband's financial difficulties. The blossoms and zephyrs of spring, the gentle but animating colors of nature heightened by the converse and smiles of her love. That is one side of the scene. The other, I dare not look at. In spite of her family crisis, Elizabeth saw the beauty of spring flowers and loving smiles they brought. And then juxtapose this sense of life-giving nature with the horrible storm descending upon the family. And then the third letter, Elizabeth's letter to Rebecca Seton, her sister-in-law. I cannot tell you how well, how happy we made our voyage yesterday. We found dear father at the wharf with such a welcome as dispelled all the grooms of my heart and made me only wish that you were present. The house so neat, the birds, the little garden, everything so cheerful. Holy nature was the first thing required. Just we were going to tea, a great punch bowl of garden strawberries crowned the feast, the sweet setting sun too. How the heart did melt before him, the giver of all. For human beings, contentment is important, and our happiness depends upon the quality of our spirituality. To live happily with little is best, and we have to care for both happiness and ecology. If we don't have both, I think it's harder to continue. So we need both, I think. The ecological value of Elizabeth's love of nature. So I'm looking at her writings from a contemporary ecological perspectives in order to, for us to understand the real value of her writings. We have seen that Elizabeth Seton's writings reveal her sensitivity and enjoyment of surrounding nature, naming each sunset, river, flower, and birds, ultimately finding the caring love of a creator in them. Now we will find the ecological meaning in Elizabeth's love and attitude toward nature when we view her writings in the light of Arne Naess, a Norwegian philosopher and the founder of deep ecology movement, who pointed out that the direct experience of nature as beautiful offers the foundational basis for our ecological way of life. Human beings can perceive and care for the diversity of their surroundings. Our biological heritage allows us to delight in this intricate living diversity. This ability to delight can be further perfected, facilitating a creative interaction with the immediate surroundings. Naess emphasized that we all have this ability to delight in nature which surrounds us, though this innate ability has to be nurtured through appreciative experiences. Arne Naess further developed the platform of deep ecology movement based on the principle that all creation has the equal right to live and blossom, and stated that for those who love nature, it is an intuitively clear and obvious value. This quality depends in part upon the deep pleasure and satisfaction we receive from close partnership with other forms of life. The attempt to ignore our dependence and to establish a master-slave role has contributed to the alienation of man from himself. Since we can control and sacrifice ourselves only when we love and find joy, it is imperative that we have direct experience of nature as beautiful and realize that nature is indispensable for our happiness. Elizabeth would have agreed with Arne Naess that human beings are not the center of the world, but everything on this earth is interconnected as the relational total field of the life flowing from God. Therefore, the happiness of a loving family affects our happiness as an integral part of the whole. Both Elizabeth Seton and Arne Naess encourage us to spend time in nature and learn to be sensitive to its seasonal changes so that its beauty can change our elegant view toward other living creatures on earth. And then the part two, Elizabeth's experience of unity with nature in her abandonment. During her experiences of abandonment, Elizabeth identified herself with the natural environment that surrounds her and learned to trust in the mercy of God. Through this identification with nature, she found the consolation and energy to rise up and pierce through the valley of suffering, a transformational act both in the natural and human world. The first example of her letters. Elizabeth's journal at the Nazaretto, a quarantine prison in Italy where she, her husband, and daughter had to spend a month. Even though every page of Elizabeth's journal at Nazaretto is inspiring, it is in the journal of December 1st, 1803, after 2 weeks of soul-searching purification, that we find a classical example of nature mysticism. Here, Elizabeth recalled how strongly she experienced God in a beautiful spring day at New Rochelle, New York, in 1789. When her father traveled to England for medical research, leaving her feeling abandoned. By juxtaposing the two extreme dark situations of Nazaretto and New Rochelle, Elizabeth reaffirmed how she met God so intimately in the bounteous beauty of God's creation. Since it reveals the important place of nature in her encounter with God, this rather long quotation must be read in its entirety. But I would read it all, it's about 3 pages, so I just summarized it. In the first paragraph, she described the present situation in Nazaretto. And in the second paragraph, she recalled her spiritual experience in New Rochelle when she was 15 years old and staying at her uncle's home. And in the third paragraph, she applied this past experience to the present. Lying under the chestnut tree and feeling the warmth of the spring, she felt love of God for 2 hours in New Rochelle. And that experience remained with her, and she said she has grown spiritually just like about 10 years that time. And that she recalls the same experience of love of God in the beautiful warmth of spring in this Nazareth. And she gained the strength again. And then another example. Elizabeth's journal at the ship from Italy. She's coming back from Italy to New York. The coral in the ocean is a branch of pale green. It is almost a rock. Its tender color is changed to the bright red. So to be submerged in the ocean of this world, subjected to the succession of the waves, ready to give up under the stress of each wave and temptation. But as soon as our soul rises, it breathes toward heaven, the pale green of our sickly hopes is changed into the pure, bright red, divine and constant love. Using an analogy of ocean coral, Elizabeth depicted the transformation of a human being. And then another example, Elizabeth's spiritual journal to Cecilia Seton, her sister-in-law. Imagining the corrupted heart in thy hand, it begged thee with all its strength to cut, pare, and remove from it whatever anguish it might undergo, whatever prevent the entrance of thy love. Again it repeats the supplication and begs it as thy greatest mercy. Cut to the center, tear up every root, let it bleed, let it suffer anything, everything, only feed it for thyself. Praise only thy love there and let humility keep sentinel, and what shall I fear? Lord, I am dust. Anybody who are aware of mystical literature knows that I am dust before you is the kind of ultimate experience of emptying oneself before God. And Elizabeth is saying this, I am dust. Elizabeth wanted to be purified by emptying herself completely, using the image of a rotten tree to portray the deep roots of our selfishness. Okay, so I also look at now this part of Elizabeth's ecological way of thinking and living from a contemporary perspective. We have seen that Elizabeth Seton has spontaneously created a space of reciprocity between nature and herself, and communicated with the beauty of mountains, sunrise, sunset, calling her friends and surrounding creatures to praise God. Elizabeth found consolation and strength by unifying experiences with the roaring waves of the ocean and sunny spring day in the forest, while the natural life forms such as the coral and rotten tree taught Elizabeth about human destiny, transformed through complete change. In much the same way, Anthony Weston, a postmodern ecological philosopher, tried to move beyond the anthropocentric worldview to which we are so accustomed and discovered a space where the possibility of reciprocity between humans and the rest of nature can be safeguarded. Weston proposed a new communicative ethics that offers a repositioning from the familiar one-species monologue to a multipolar dialogue with the natural world. In order to open up the possibility of reciprocity, we need not only to safeguard a space that is not wholly permeated by humans, but also to create space which is conceptual and experiential, as well as literal, physical, where we can feel seasonal changes with wind, stars, silence, and bird songs. He portrayed a biotic community which is far more tolerant and inclusive. The crucial thing is that humans must neither monopolize the picture entirely nor absent ourselves from it completely, but rather try to live in interaction, to create a space for genuine encounter as part of our ongoing reconstruction of our own lives and practices. What will come of such encounters, what will emerge from such sustained interactions, we cannot yet say. Of course, Elizabeth's communication with nature was not intentional as to draw out communicative ethics, but as she herself wrote, spontaneously and intuitively, she heard a loud praise of the Creator in magnificent nature and responded to it by her praise of God. Most probably, she was trained in this communicative understanding of the universe by her continual reading and reflection on the Psalms that summon all creation to the praise of God. And part three, Elizabeth's awareness of ecological balance. First example, Elizabeth's letter to Julia, her friend. I write only to wish you a happy new year and to tell you if the news of our misfortunes has reached you, that you must do as I do. Hope the best. Dear Julia, how long I have been tired of this busy scene, but it is not likely to mend. And I must kiss Dick, that's her baby son, Dick, and be thankful what remains from the ruins of the Wall Street, where she lived. Heaven grant you all a happy century, if it is but a happy one. You know, even in this, the worst situation, she kept the balance, in a way. She realized she's realistic enough where her family is now, but at the same time, she didn't lose hope. She kept her balance and her composure. And another example, Elizabeth's letter to Eliza Sadler, another of her very good friends. Well, dearest, so we go, the wheel goes round. This is the way her fish thought, the wheel goes round. Yeah. Precious, inestimable privilege. May we look up all the while. Elizabeth perceived the suffering, illness, and death are inescapable lot for us. Yet, also precious privileges once we learn to bear them. The wheel of joy and suffering goes round with equity, maturing, transforming us. Yet how many of us will proclaim as did she, that suffering is a precious, inestimable privilege? I think it will be not easy for me to do, you know. It really takes a real faith, I think, to do that. And then another example, Elizabeth's insight of equity and balance in the light of Bookchin's social ecology. So it's I'm trying to look see from a contemporary perspective. Murray Bookchin thought that the root of ecological crisis is the concept of hierarchy, which has promoted discrimination and oppression in human history. He was convinced that hierarchy is not only a social condition, but also the state of our consciousness, which carries the sensitivity of all our various experiences. By hierarchy, I mean the cultural, traditional, and political system to which the terms class and state most appropriately refer. His social ecology tries to overcome hierarchy in human community first, thereby building a dynamic harmony where nature and humans live together in peace. A distinct human natural community, the social as well as organic factors that interrelate to provide a basis for an ecologically rounded and balanced community. In other words, the aim of social ecology is to achieve freedom in human society, which will naturally lead to the reconciliation between nature and humans. Bookchin thought that a true ecology of freedom will be accomplished when social freedom and natural freedom support each other. In spite of an apparent common goal, Bookchin is very different from Elizabeth in that he proposed a completely rational ecology, criticizing religious faith as the snare that limits human freedom. Whereas for Elizabeth, it was God's equity in nature and human experiences that equalizes everything and offers freedom. Although Elizabeth and Bookchin represent two fundamentally different worldviews in our contemporary age, it is consoling to know that at their core, their social goals converge, and that both agree that we should work for the equitable distribution of resources on this earth among all living beings, enabling all the freedom of life in an interdependent community. Okay, part four. Elizabeth's focus on present, moderation, and harmony. Elizabeth called present God's blessed time. She understood that each of us meet God in the present moment. Example one, Elizabeth's letter to Julia. But this is a subject it is a bane to indulge, for who shall dare to look into futurity, the future? How different were my prospect in the last year from the present? And if I now plan the futurity, it may never be realized, and if it is, the causes of apprehension may be lessened, perhaps removed. Therefore, to intend the best and be thankful for the present is the only plan I can reserve on. It is clear that Elizabeth was not just enduring this situation. Indeed, she was thankful for the present. It was in the present, after all, that she was able to receive the grace of the moment that comes in difficult challenges. Another example, Elizabeth's two letters to Rebecca Seton, her sister-in-law. I have often told you, my Rebecca, that I had determined never again to allow myself the enjoyment of any affection beyond the bound of moderation. I make a rule never to answer letters whilst under the influence of what impression I receive from them. Elizabeth acquired meekness and cheerfulness by the constant practice of moderation in all her actions. For her, moderation was related not only to material possession, but also to emotional enjoyment. Another example, Elizabeth's three letters to Eliza. As I think, the first point of religion is cheerfulness and harmony. They who have this in view are certainly right. Peace, peace, oh, the very sound is harmony. Take the all in all, I am well content. Well, internal peace is mine, let them go round and round. Another example, Elizabeth's letter to Julia. My case cannot be worse, nor can it be better for my real enjoyment than it is now. Which I have you, Mrs. Seton, her godmother, and Antonio Felici. That is saying a great deal, but it is truly so. Nothing can be worse than a state of dependence, but if it is my allotment, it cannot be better than when supplied by the hands of real friendship. Although well aware of undesirable condition of dependency, Elizabeth graciously received help because she understood that God puts all things in their proper order. Sometimes that means we stand on the side of the receiver. And then now I look at from her another contemporary ecological perspective. Aldo Leopold, the first contemporary scholar who raised the question of our ecological conscience toward the non-human, stated that ecological concern or conservation must spring from a sense of individual responsibility for the general health of the land. He appealed that we have to quit thinking about decent land use as solely an economic problem, whether we should examine each question in terms of what is ethically and aesthetically right, as well as what is economically expedient. After describing a biotic view and ecological dynamics of land community, Leopold proposed a land ethic. A thing is right when it tends to preserve the integrity, stability, and beauty of the biotic community. It is wrong when it tends otherwise. These three ethical norms of Leopold land ethics, integrity, stability, and beauty, are quite significant for the deeper understanding of Elizabeth Seton's ecological spirituality. As we have seen, Elizabeth appreciated and respected the integrity, stability, and beauty of this earth through her insight into God's equity and mercy in all creation. However, what appears prominently in Elizabeth's ecological spirituality is her sensitivity and love for the beauty of nature. According to Aldo Leopold, human beings act not only by intellectual speculation, but also by direct emotional experience. Since beauty draws out love from our heart, it is only when we love that we are willing to sacrifice our conveniences in order to nurture another life. After their careful observations of nature, Aldo Leopold and Elizabeth Seton conversed on the practical wisdom of moderation. In his Ascend County Almanac, Leopold stated that moderation is best virtue if we want to live ecologically. It is well that the planting season comes only in spring, for moderation is best in all things, even shovels, yes. During the other months, we may watch the process of becoming a pine. This same sense of waiting for the natural growth and moderation in all things matured Elizabeth's spirituality with its distinctive ecological flavor. Near to nature and its seasonal changes, Elizabeth was able to identify her own sufferings within the universal equity of God. This wide ecological vision of how total creation works in the providence of God preserved her in harmony and contentment, or as Leopold wrote, conservation is a state of harmony between man and land. Now my final conclusion. Elizabeth saw the whole of God's creation in its totality and also understood the relationship within it. Her relationship with nature was fundamental to the formation and maturity of her spirituality. And as intimate and strong as her relationship with other human beings. Of course, God, as the creator of both nature and humanity, always remained at the center of her heart, uniting and vivifying her sensitivity to all creation. I have tried to view ecological dimensions of our spirituality in the light of four major contemporary philosophers of ecology, Aldo Leopold, Arne Naess, Murray Bookchin, and Anthony Weston. The message of Pope Benedict XVI echoes the ecological spirituality of St. Elizabeth Ann Seton. Nor must we forget the very significant fact that many people experience peace and tranquility, renewal, reinvigoration, when they come into close contact with the beauty and harmony of nature. There exists a certain reciprocity. As we care for creation, we realize that God, through creation, cares for us. After I finished writing this, you know, that Pope Francis has published his important encyclical on ecology, very both natural ecology and social and human ecology. So I just added that little less paragraph. Finally, I would like to point out how much Pope Francis' theme resonates with Elizabeth's spirituality. Because all creatures are connected, each must be cherished with love and respect. For all of us as living creatures are dependent on each other. I also see a close resemblance in Elizabeth's ecological spirituality with Pope Francis' vision of the integral ecology. Thank you. I'll be very happy if you have any comments or questions or whatever you like. Yes. Father Udovi.
Sisters, we know Emmitsburg is a beautiful natural environment. And so when you put the combination of Elizabeth, Emmitsburg, and founding a new community, do you see ways in which the three of those interconnect? Now, excuse me, if this is her spirituality, then it had to be expressed as she founded the community and drew those first sisters around her in the context of the beauties of Emmitsburg that surrounded them.
Yeah. That's very good, Father, because this time I only concentrate on volume 1. But volume to the next, my task is to write another article on volume two. And I started it, you know. So the volume two is from Baltimore and Emmitsburg, and her work with sisters, the students, while she's keeping her family community within it. So these things are going at the same time. And she, amazingly, she managed it. Of course, sometimes it was very taxing on her, but, you know. So that's what I am, I'm working on it. So next time, when I see you in whatever context, I might be able to share with you. Any other? Yes, please. Yes.
So did you look at other environmental philosophers? And if so, what drew you to these four? Did you sort of look at some that were spoke to you more and some less? Or how did that process work?
Yeah. Before I came to Chicago 7 years ago, I was working with the special project on ecology in a multi-religious perspective, because I was involved in inter-religious dialogue. I was a director of the center. And Louvain University and Belgium invited us. So some of us went there for a year, and we prepared before that about 3 years before we go. And we had a team teaching, and then after we came, we continued. So about 10 years, I was working with ecological philosophers, especially the main movements. I usually like to go to the real source, the beginners, founders of each thinking, you know. So that Arne Naess is deep ecology, and Murray Bookchin is social ecology, Aldo Leopold, as you know, biotic community and land ethics. And Weston is probably the least known person, and he is starting, however, more contemporary approach to his. So I was thinking, I chose this because while I was reading it, I was reading a volume one from the first page until the last page. And I was taking out what I feel there is a ecological insight in her. And then I put together, and these four scholars that I have studied meant, this is the from their light I can give a more meaning to Elizabeth. So that's the way I connected. But they are the main thinkers of the major trend of philosophical thought for 40 years, I think. Yes.
Would you also have any initial insights on how her ecological spirituality get played out in her conversion?
Her conversion. That's a good question and interesting, but I have to think, you know. Her conversion, yeah, there is a few examples that when she and when Antonio Felice first taught her sign of the cross, it was under the moonlight. She said that, you know. But how that moonlight experienced her, that I'm not sure. I might have to think more about it, you know. And her struggle in New York after she came back, that I introduced the rotten tree, that had something in her. So she was not she was a very deep thinker, you know. She was not that easily persuaded either way. And she was really coping with God, and this conversion is just not just changing from one church to another, but it's her really life and death choice, and in order to be really united to the will of God. So she was really working her purification of her heart, So that that kind of a rotten tree, coral, all those things are part of her way of going to God. So I think it does make some significant meaning in her. But I think a little more about it, unless you have some other ideas to offer.
And it just strikes me that for someone that it is so constitutive of her, you know, you would see, you know, I would certainly you see it in her relationships with her in-laws or with her children.
Yes.
But each, it's a slightly different expression, and so it would be interesting in the follow of this as a theme throughout her life, from beginning to end. I think that by, you know, I think after you do volume two, you do volume three, and I think there's a tremendous integral story here to be told from the beginning and end of her life, and how it develops and how it goes from one point through her experience to another.
Yes, thank you for that observation, because that's good. I do by book by book, but I should not forget the continuity.
Yeah.
So I do book by book because, you know, the material was so much, you know, and also book three is very challenging to me, because I'm almost finished it, and I was talking with Judy Matt, who is a historian. What do you do with this book three, which is not only written by her, but it's she copied a lot.
Yeah.
So this copying material and her own, how shall I deal with it, you know? So that's one of my big problem with it, you know. But some, of course, translations, but that's... I think, Father, you wanted to say something.
Yeah, it's... thank you for the great presentation. It's very intriguing. And it's opening my mind towards the conversation around the issue of ecology. And that really brought me to think about how we can reconcile the idea that you pointed out on page 4, the second paragraph, about Elizabeth would have agreed with Arne Naess that human beings are not the center of the world. That caught me off guard, because when I look at the book of Genesis, it's like it just fits just the opposite. Also, do we understand? Like Genesis chapter 1, verse 27, it says, so, verse 28, God blessed them and said to them, be fruitful, said to man, be fruitful and increase in number, fill the earth and subdue it. Rule over the fish in the sea and the birds in the sky and over every living creature that moves on the ground, and make them, you eat them and you dominate them. So that one caught me off guard, and I thought maybe there is a new way of understanding that biblical context.
Yes, yes it is, yeah. And these days we do a lot about how to, one problem with our Bible scriptures, there are different kinds of resources there. Some are still very anthropocentric, while some are much wider. And God is at the center of universe. We are only made it, just like what you just said, you know, chapter 2 of Genesis, that say we are the guardians, we are the caretakers of the garden. We are not the master, you know, so that it's how you, so that, and there is a whole ecological reading of scriptures these days. Yeah. It makes a little wider, and so make us a little more humble. Because sometimes the traditional way of translating Bible make us very anthropocentric. And we think this is the way God made us, but probably not. You know, so we have to look at, you know. Yes.
Thank you, sister. What does perhaps Elizabeth say about the animal kingdoms? Following up regarding the question on Genesis, the need for humans to keep pets like dogs, livestock, you know, farming for food. And in her world, before there were automobiles, horses were just so ubiquitous. You know, they were just, you know, a part of everybody's lives every day.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah, one thing When I was studying the ecology, animal rights is one big part of the ecological movement these days, you know. Of course, Elizabeth's time, that whole the crisis was not there, so it was not as a big issue as like it. But she was very interested in the happiness of animals, that she knew, like I just mentioned here, a Robin family, you know. What it is, the one of young girl, I don't know how she was related to her, but anyhow, she had a little, cut the robin and put in the cage. And so this little robin's mother and father was around it, didn't leave the little baby. So Elizabeth saw and saw the terrible situation this Robin family. So she persuaded this young girl, please let the little one go. So she finally was persuaded and opened the door for the case, and little one go, and the family were happily gone. And then she also asked somebody, I think, to bring some nice gift for the girl, the good work that she has done. So she's sensitive to both Robin family and this girl who lost this little pet that she just found, you know. So that is how you take care of it. So there is a definite, I think, centeredness that, and sensitivity Elizabeth felt for the, you know, the animal field and the goose that was welcoming her to the Emmitsburg. She said, we are the same kind. Yes, we do. We are the same living beings of God, you know. So that kind of feeling was with her, but this big, but I think she ate meat, I think.
Mm-hmm. Do you think chicken
so? Chicken
eggs.
Chicken and eggs, okay. So then it was not like a complete, you know, refusal of not eating or something. So, but hers is a moderation. Everything simple and what we really need. You know. Do you want to?
Oh, I think your presentation was wonderful, Sung-Hae. Thank you. But as I was listening, I was wondering, I do think she was very sensate and very intuitive and very sensitive. And later on in another volume, she talks about how horrified she was as a little girl when some playmates would throw robin eggs on the ground. She was horrified. But we know very little about her schooling. We only know it was supposedly like a home school. And we do have one copybook that Dr. Ellen Kelly went through and is published through Vincentian Heritage. We know that was her school book. And it occurred to me, it would be interesting to see what, as a schoolgirl, she may have written or copied in that book that could have helped to form her as a young one in the ecological vein. But also her father was a doctor, and so there would be a natural appreciation of nature. But there's so much that we don't know, and we do, like you say, just have to tease it out of situations. But it's always amazed me that as a woman who is in a terrible situation with the lazaretto and a dying husband and a child to entertain, she can look out and comment on the beauty of the sunset.
Yeah. And she found the strength from
it. Yes, yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. Yes.
Sister, there were a number of things in your presentation that made me think that ecological spirituality provides a really fertile area for dialogue with Buddhist philosophy. And I'm wondering if that could, if that's an area where your community's work in Korea and China especially, where that kind of spirituality could work toward increased dialogue.
Yeah, Yeah, true. Yes, I know the last 10 years interreligious work was done by 10 scholars who represent 4 different religions in Korea: Buddhist, Confucian, Taoist, and one Buddhism, who is a contemporary form of Buddhism. And when we went to Leuven, 4 were represented. So that there is a list of 3 books published in Korean already on that line: multi-religious perspective on ecological spirituality. So, but it's not in English, so I cannot recommend you, you know. But that part is working well, I think, in some other groups of people. You're right, I think Buddhism is very strong on ecological thinking, and also Taoism, those two are very strong. Confucianism is very much human-centered, like we are. Yes.
Did she have any trouble with any clergy, whether other religions or own religions, and when she made these arguments?
I didn't get your question fully.
Did she have any trouble with clergy and other
clergy?
Religions or own religions?
Oh, yes, she had a lot of trouble. She had a lot of trouble, especially Father David, who was her the superior of the house. So, but that will come in volume 2. How I will deal with it, I have to think about it. No, what's amazing is she had a lot of difficulties in the church, but at the same time, beautiful friendship with Bishop Carroll, who really supported her founding a community. So she had both pros and cons, and she knew that that's the human life. Mm-hmm. Nothing is perfect. So, but she knew how to live with this, the joys of life and sufferings of life. And that, I think, is her wisdom. And she learned it a lot that from the nature. Yes.
Just much like you were sharing Elizabeth's letter to Julia, I want to thank you for bringing us to the present in a very mindful way. It was a real gift in this last hour. And my just question I had was curious, if we were new to the Sisters of Charity and we were to be meeting different communities today, how might we find this ecological spirituality alive or embraced in different ways today? In a community of Sisters of Charity.
Communities. I think we are trying this ecological sustainability is a big thing in almost all the congregations, and especially after Pope Francis, you know, published this Laudato Si, we know it's just something that it's our calling that we should do something about it. Not only for our own communities, but also for the world as a whole. So we are all trying. So each community are trying, and let's see, do you have anything to contribute? yours is a big community, actually, yeah. Daughters of Charity.
Each of our communities in the Sisters of Charity Federation has different geographic, was born in a different place. So I know that the Sisters of Charity of New York had a farm up in New York, the north of the city, and Cincinnati had Paula Gonzalez and a sustainability house. And in Evansville, there's a large, it's bigger than a community garden, but it's a farm that's run, it's a community farm that the Daughters of Charity are working with. But through the membership, I think everyone is being educated and growing and learning things that we didn't learn when we entered more than 10 years ago, because the world is changing. And there are other communities of that I know are doing, well, look at your study. I think this is probably the most significant, I mean, Sister Sung-Hae is the most
well informed in this deep sense on the whole matter.
An energy audit, we try to have energy audit. So they're checking ourselves and then also try to share with others those things.
Thank you so much.